These 3D prints
are garbage.
And no, I'm not talking about the print quality because they're actually pretty decent. I'm talking about the fact that they are literally made from repurposed municipal waste. No, I don't mean that someone just yanked the plastic out of the dumpster to make recycled filament. I mean that this filament, made with an innovative compound called UBQ, is literally made of mostly garbage. Banana peels, diapers, and all. Now, we're going to get into how it prints and all of that in a little bit, but first, I'm sure that you have a lot of questions about the material itself. Fortunately, for all the questions I'm sure you guys will have, I actually have Liat Arad here, who is the VP of Marketing of UBQ. Thanks for coming in, Liat.
Hi, John. Thanks for having me.
So, we're going to talk about what this filament actually is in a second, but first, let's talk about UBQ, which is the material that goes into making this filament. What is it?
Okay, so essentially what UBQ is a thermoplastic made entirely from household waste. So we take all the waste that you're making in your bin, whether it's banana peels, chicken bones, dirty diapers, which is something that both of us have in our lives, and we turn all of that unrecyclable waste into a new material called UBQ.
Wow. That sounds very resource intensive, and it sounds like it takes a lot of manpower and a lot of energy to turn trash into a material.
It's not. So let me go a little bit into how we turn waste into UBQ. So essentially the process is we take everything that would have otherwise been landfilled or incinerated. And again, that's all the organics, mixed plastics. We take out metals and minerals. So any glass, sand, things like that, to make sure that the thermoplastic at the end is nice and clean,
right,
which is a funny way to describe waste. And essentially, you don't think about it, but your waste at home is over 80% organic. That's
wow.
Paper, food, garden trimmings, cardboard. So that 80% is broken down into its basic particles, which is lignin, cellulose, fibers, and sugars.
Mm-hmm.
And then the rest is the mixed plastic that gets melted into a thermoplastic.
And so the energy from all those organics is actually used to melt down the other 20%, which turns into a plastic.
So first of all, we don't burn anything. So
okay,
all the waste goes in together. And when we break down the organics into its basic particles, it's reconstituted into a matrix, almost like if you can think about like sticky cotton candy, that
wow,
kind of runs in together. And then that's this new, completely novel material, which is UBQ.
Wow. So it's just using chemistry, kind of secret proprietary process of chemistry, to reuse the energy to create these chemical reactions. And then you get UBQ, and that then can go into other things like 3D printer filament, injection molded
right,
plastic, stuff like that.
Extrusion, etc.
Interesting. And you've told me in the past that I should think about UBQ kind of like tofu. Tell me a bit about that.
Yes. Well, we don't recommend you eating UBQ. The reason we talk about UBQ as tofu is because we don't sell UBQ for the mechanical properties of the material.
Right.
We're selling it essentially as a sustainability additive.
Okay.
So whatever it's compounded with, whether it be polypropylene, PE, TPO, PLA, it generally takes on the mechanical properties of whatever material it's compounded with.
Got it.
So it kind of works with that composition.
So really the main benefit here is environmental.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so we're thinking about, you know, instead of using 100% pure virgin material, we can get similar or almost the same, kind of depending on who's compounding it.
And yes.
Similar, same properties, except this can have a much lower carbon footprint. Theoretically, it could have a negative carbon footprint because we're keeping
right,
things out of the landfill.
Right, so let's go back a little bit and talk about how that math works out.
Yeah.
So how does the fact that we make this product out of waste turn into this carbon economy calculations? So essentially every ton of UBQ that's made here in Israel, by the way, is diverting 1.3 tons of waste from landfills.
Wow.
When we're diverting waste from landfill, we are actually preventing 11.7 tons of CO2 equivalent, mostly methane,
right,
if anyone's
right,
familiar with that.
Right.
So from polluting the environment, for every ton of UVQ that we make, it's about 1.3 tons of waste.
Wow.
And most of that delta is actually just moisture. So you asked about how much resources we use in converting waste into UVQ. It's very little because a lot of that moisture, like we don't use any water, we're using the moisture that's already in the waste. We're not going up to high temperature degrees because so much of our feedstock is organic, so we don't want to burn it. So we're using much lower temperatures, no water, no sludge, no effluents. So the process is actually very clean. And then we're able to do that calculation of 1 ton of UVQ is equivalent to minus 11.7 tons of CO2 equivalent.
That's amazing. For folks in the audience, how far are they from getting to a point where their household trash is getting turned into UVQ?
So we're in the process of expansion. UVQ, a little history, is we've been around since 2012. Mm-hmm. The first 7 years were stealth mode, lot of research and development. But today we have a facility here in Israel, and we have a very large facility going up in Holland and Bergen-op-Zoom, Netherlands, which will be open later on this year. And we're actively expanding. So we're looking at places in the US, we're looking at locations, additional locations in Europe, and maybe Japan, so on and so forth. So it's up to you guys to kind of help get your officials to know about UVQ and demand that more products are made with UVQ.
Liat, thank you so much for coming in.
Absolutely.
Okay, so that's a bit about how the additive UVQ is made, but what about turning it into filament? And how does this stuff actually print? Well, we're going to get into that in just 1 second, but first I need to go ahead and thank this episode's sponsor, which is Skillshare. I've actually used and taught on Skillshare for years, and to be honest, whether you're looking to create new career possibilities, start your own business like I recently have, or just enrich your skills in your hobbies, Skillshare is the best place to do it. That's because Skillshare offers an all-you-can-eat smorgasbord of amazing courses on just about every topic you could ever want to learn, all for one low monthly fee. I, for example, have really been enjoying leveling up my CAD skills with this great Onshape course, but you could also use Skillshare to improve your productivity, learn how to make YouTube videos, or become a better writer. Best of all, the first 1,000 people to use the link in the description below are going to get a free one-month trial of Skillshare. All right. Now, let's get back into the video. Where were we? Oh, yeah, turning those refined UVQ pellets into actual 3D printing filament that you and I can use. For that, UVQ partnered with another company here in Israel, Plastics App, that specializes in developing unique and tailor-made polymers for various applications and industries. Plastics App, in turn, took the finished UVQ additive and created a few different unique compounds for making it 3D printable. They were kind enough to send me one of those compounds, this roll of EZQ, designed to be as easily printable as possible. Though the exact composition of each roll is a closely guarded secret, Plastics App has assured me that this roll is still significantly composed of UVQ, as opposed to a lot of added virgin material, and that their goal in developing it was either carbon neutrality or even a negative carbon footprint. The bottom line? This filament is basically made of trash. Highly refined, technological miracle trash, but trash nonetheless. But does it print like trash? I had my doubts, especially because just trying to insert it into the printer, it proved to be incredibly brittle, akin to a wood-fill filament. And yet, I was pretty blown away by the printability, and I was even able to print it on my super-fast Bamboo Lab X1 Carbon. To be clear, because of the UVQ additive, you do need to print this material with a wear-resistant nozzle of at least 0.6 millimeters in diameter, such as the new Gamma Master nozzle that Slice Engineering was kind enough to send over. But otherwise, it pretty much prints like normal. After seeing Zach Friedman's recent Cursed Filament series, I honestly expected this stuff to be much harder to print with. But in all truth, all it took was a generous amount of drying the filament out, much more than I would have with PLA, for example, and then dialing in settings like retraction and heat. Surprisingly, despite having so much additive in it, it prints best at 190 degrees Celsius, and when it's properly dry, the prints are almost indistinguishable from matte PLA or a fiber-filled PLA like this wood one. Though, admittedly, for some of these prints, I got lazy and didn't dry the filament all the way out, so do excuse some of that extra stringing. And because I know you're wondering, no, there isn't a nasty smell when you print it, though there also isn't that sweet smell that virgin PLA admits either. Now, I know that you're probably also curious about the material's strength, and so while this definitely isn't CNC Kitchen, drop a comment below if you'd like to see me FedEx the rest of this roll to Stefan for more serious testing. I did go ahead and buy some test equipment to see just how strong this stuff really was. And while I did use Stefan's exact settings for printing the hooks out, let's just say that my methods were less than scientific. And because of time constraints and having to constantly feed the algorithm, I admittedly did have a very small sample size in my testing. With all that said, from my very, very limited testing, the environmental benefits of this material definitely do come at a cost, and my test samples broke at about 1/4 the load of Stefan's PLA samples. I'm sure that with more tweaking, I could get much better results, and keep in mind, this is the EZQ version of the filament. They do have a high performance version available. But there's no two ways about it. The strength of this material is a bit disappointing, and it may limit its practical application. Another bit of disappointing news is the price. The roll that I tested sells for 51 euros for a 550 gram spool, which makes this some of the more expensive filament you can buy. Though I'm sure that economies of scale could bring those prices down if it were mass produced. Nonetheless, I was really, really happy to hear when Yanir, the CEO of Plastics App, told me that they have still had a lot of interest from all different kinds of industrial consumers, including automotive manufacturers, lighting and home goods designers, architecture firms, and more for this kind of filament, which kind of made me realize. Sometimes, especially in the context of business use, strength or even aesthetics are really not what you're optimizing for. As consumers, we're almost always looking for the strongest, best-looking part at the lowest possible costs. But imagine if you're an automotive manufacturer, a designer, or an architect designing tens, hundreds, or even thousands of prototypes that you know are inevitably going to be scrapped. Well, in that case, you either want to recycle the material, which isn't always possible, or you want to use a material that you know had a significantly lower carbon footprint, so that the overall environmental impact of your business is effectively lowered. And if your business, like so many major companies out there like Apple, has the goal of becoming 100% carbon neutral or even carbon negative, integrating this material into your design or production process could be a big part of that strategy. A strategy which, of course, has other benefits, like increasing your stock price or bringing you in line with regulations or keeping customers happy. But hey, don't get me wrong, I definitely don't think that this filament is only useful for things that you're planning to throw away. I'm quite sure that although the strength isn't nearly as good as virgin PLA, this material with its earthy, nice look could be used in all kinds of finished products as well, either inside the product or outside. I gotta be honest, I kinda like the textured finish, and if you're selling to environmentally conscious consumers, I think that the story behind this filament can actually be a major selling point. And keep in mind, 3D printing is just one very niche application of UBQ's technology. When used in other manufacturing processes such as injection molding, UBQ is actually already being used by major multinational corporations, companies like McDonald's, Mercedes-Benz, and more. And it's being used in finished products that consumers are using every single day. The bottom line, this filament may be quite expensive and quite weak compared to virgin materials, but it represents a really awesome application of a cutting-edge technology for solving one of the most pressing problems facing humanity today. What are we gonna do with all of our garbage? While I don't think that you're going to see rolls of UBQ-infused filament on the shelves at Micro Center anytime soon, I do think that it's awesome that industrial customers have the option to use this type of material in their prototyping and production processes. And I certainly hope to see more trash skipping the landfill and ending up in more of the products that I use every single day. But hey, what do all of you think? Could you ever see yourself printing with garbage if the prices were similar to a normal roll of filament? Could you see the company that you work at using this as part of a bigger strategy to reduce carbon emissions? And most importantly, are you guys interested in seeing more videos like this one about 3D printing innovations? I'd love to know in the comments below. I want to take a quick moment once again to thank Skillshare for sponsoring this episode. Thanks to UBQ and Liat over at UBQ, as well as Yanir over at Plastics App for providing me with materials, B-roll, information, and of course the filament. And of course, thanks to my Patreon supporters who help me do this every single week. Oh, and thanks to all of you for watching, liking, subscribing, using my referral links below, and all the wonderful things you guys do to support me, because it really, really does make a difference. That's all for now, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.